Hello, good evening and welcome to In The Know, brought to you by The Racing Post and Coral. On a Thursday night, a bit of a rare excursion on a Thursday, because of course we are off to Lexington, Kentucky for a bit of Breeders' Cup action on Friday and Saturday night. And hopefully you'll be watching it as well, because it's at a very reasonable hour this year, which is definitely a bit of a bonus. And we're going to be going through pretty much every race, maybe not with a fine-tooth comb, but hopefully trying to find one or two winners and angles at Keeneland over the next couple of days, and just trying to sort out the European runners, of course, from the American challenges as well. Now, the European challenge looks pretty strong, maybe not quite as strong as last year necessarily, but they'll be hoping to better their numbers at Keeneland from a couple of years ago, and the Europeans came home with four winners and two on the first time at Keeneland. This is, of course, the third time we've been at Keeneland, the home of horse racing in America for the Breeders' Cup. And hopefully, like I said, we'll have 14 fantastic races and 14 fantastic winners. No pressure panel for tonight's show. We are live and interactive, of course, on YouTube and Facebook, and this should be a little bit longer than usual as well, because, I mean, quite frankly, there's a lot to get through. So do get in touch. Get in touch on the chat box and let us know your thoughts on what you'll be backing and what you'll be opposing over the next couple of days. So please get involved. All those cards and information will, of course, also be available on the Racing Post app as well. The brand new Racing Post app is available to download right now, so get it, get involved, and get stuck in to the Breeders' Cup action on Friday and Saturday night. So, without further ado, let's see who will be going through the races over the next couple of days with me. Danny DeVito, Queen Latifah, Frank Sinatra, Meryl Streep, all famous New Jersey residents, but none of them know quite as much about horse racing as our Garden State panellists tonight. Rachel Candelora, welcome.
Welcome, great research. Good own intro, I mean.
There you go.
If only I could be half as much as them.
Yeah. Who's your favourite fellow New Jersey resident? All.
Oh, it's got to be the boss. I mean, Bruce Springsteen. I mean, not just that, like, he's...
Was he from New Jersey? I don't think he ever mentioned it.
No, just one. There might have been a song.
Yeah, one or two, yeah.
No, because he actually grew up in the town that I grew up in, and his daughter was very into horses. Not horse racing, but Olympic eventing, and at a very high level, but... You gotta represent with the music. So
absolutely, and excited about the next couple of nights.
Oh, I mean, today is like Christmas Eve, and then and then Saturday is like Boxing Day. It's fantastic with the five races tomorrow, and it's really competitive. And then just all the races Saturday, and because it's a Kentucky Breeders' Cup, and the time they haven't changed it, so it's only 4 hours, so we don't have to stay up to like 1:30 in the morning to wait for the classic to actually run.
Very reasonable, isn't
it? No, it's fantastic, and what
a
classic.
It's a twilight meeting.
No, it's beautiful, and like actually the great thing is sometimes the classic in the last couple of years has sort of been the damp squib of the entire meeting, but this time it's just building, and it's the question of, is Flightline as good as he looks, or is there going to be a chink in the armour?
Yeah, you're right, that's the question. The last couple of years, you kind of, especially with what time it's been on, there's definitely been looking at watch thinking, shall I just go to bed and watch it tomorrow? But you'd be mad if you did that this year, especially as it'd be a very early night for you. But joining us in the studio as well, two people in the studio for In The Know as well, what an absolute treat. One of the most recognisable voices in racing, and no stranger to an American racing excursion himself. Mark Johnson, are you as excited as Rachel is?
I am indeed. I've attended four Breeders' Cups, but I think I've never been as excited for a Breeders' Cup that I haven't attended myself in person as I am about this year. Because I think the solidity right throughout the entire series, the 5 2-year-old races on the opening day, there are definite angles in each of those. And then, as Richard just said, it builds to a crescendo in the classic, but there's some real belters, both on the dirt and on the turf, when we go through Saturday. No, I think it's a really good series.
Yeah, it's a fair point, actually. Last year, there was probably two, maybe three races with, smallish fields, what looked like odds on certainties. Yes. Didn't necessarily work out that way. But there's not really a race where you think, this could have been a bit better.
No, and I think the other thing is, as good as Del Mar is, the track, both the turf and the dirt at Keeneland are fairer.
Yeah.
You've got a longer run off the final turn on the turf, which gives the closers more of a chance. We've got the two finishing lines, which we'll be pointing out on the dirt track, because we have three races over the short stretch and the rest are over the long stretch. So three of the races, it may suit front runners. The others, it's a more open playing surface again. But generally, there are less hard luck stories in a Keeneland Breeders' Cup than you're going to get at a Del Mar.
Yeah, Chester of the West, I think it was a bit. Mm-hmm.
Let's call it that, yeah.
Yeah, it was Del Mar. But in fact, well, actually, I'll tell you what, before we get into it, I'm already getting excited as well. We better introduce Simon Clare. I mean, if we're excited, Simon, you, like I said, every time there's an international meeting, you're bouncing off the walls. 14 races, as Mark said, not a weak one amongst them.
Oh. Yeah, sound pretty heightened. And me too. I mean, I was lucky enough to go to 23 Breeders' Cups in a row from 97 to 2019. And the pandemic ruined my fun. And I haven't been to the last two, and I won't be there this year. My plans are to be back in California for next year. But actually, you know, to be watching on television for the last couple of years is amazingly rewarding as well. You know, what you miss out from not being there. And my God, it's great fun. So if you're watching, you haven't been, make sure you get out to the Breeders' Cup at some stage. It still is an amazing televisual event as well. We can follow everything and the great coverage you get from the American broadcasters and indeed the UK broadcaster out there. And we're blessed with ITV coverage as well both nights, which is fantastic and gives so many more people the opportunity to follow this incredible event. So I can't wait.
Lovely stuff. And props to you as well, Simon, for digging through the wardrobe and finding something with a little stars and stripes in the corner there as well.
It's a logo of a design. It's a Gantt logo.
Was that intentional? Was that intentional?
I thought I'd dress up. Normally I have a polo shirt on, but I thought this is a big night, big event. I put a proper shirt on.
Lovely stuff. Well, I mean, I've got a red shirt. I've got a white T-shirt under here, and I'm wearing blue trousers. So I did make the effort as well. It's just I thought you were. Yeah, I was going to go full Abraham Lincoln, but I thought maybe not. It was Halloween earlier on in the week, wasn't it? Simon. So, okay, well, before we get stuck into it, do you want to tell us what you've got?
Yes.
Offer, 6 till 7 specific offer for the racing?
Yeah. I think we should do, yeah, because it's a 1 hour offer on one of the big favourites for Europe, actually. One of the stories, really, Nashua, ridden by Holly Doyle in the filly and mare turf. She's one of the shortest price favourites for the European. She's 6 to 4 currently, generally. And we're going to go 2 to 1 for the next hour. Maximum bet of £20 to spread it around to as many people as want to take advantage of that. So up until 7 p.m, you can get a bit of 2 to 1 Nashua for £20. And just a couple of other mentions, it's best price guaranteed on all 14 races now. So if you take any prices, even this evening, and they go off bigger come race night on either Friday or Saturday, you'll get the bigger price. And we've got loads of extra places we'll talk through during the 14 races. But Nashua, 2 to 1, up to £20 per customer.
Okay, Nashua to try and avenge her unlucky defeat at Longchamp then is 2 to 1 out from 6 to 4 until 7 p.m. Like I said at the top of the show, don't forget to download the Racing Post app as well. The brand new one is available right now, and quite frankly, it's just absolutely chock full of information, and you can go through the cards from Keeneland and every other meeting this weekend as well and get exclusive tips too. So get that involved in your life right now. Before we move on, the one thing I was going to ask you guys, you were talking about the track. Rather than what it isn't, where are we thinking draw-wise? How does it unfold race-wise? Because obviously, from a UK punter's perspective, you ask anyone in the street, they'll tell you where you want to be drawn, left, right, and centre, up and down the UK and Ireland. Where are they going to come from at Keeneland?
Well, it depends where the speed comes from.
I mean, that's that is true.
I mean, you know, you just read about all these stats on the dirt track for the outside of the juvenile fillies and the dirt mile. You have the long stretch, so it doesn't particularly matter. There was a lot of kickback early on in the meet, which was really hitting the horses in behind. Mm. Sink, Southall, Fiber Sound, not now.
Well, that's what I was thinking. So, is there a potential for a dead rail scenario?
No, because it got fixed during the 4 weeks of the fall meet. They ran into it, and they've only not been racing for a week as Churchill Downs opened. So that's not. I would say it's a fair level track as they ended the fall meet a week ago.
The older viewers out there, they always used to say that on television. For the older viewers, you may remember that the Keenelander was always a golden highway. Mm. If you got on the rail, you got in front, you didn't get caught. And probably on every race card, if there were 7 races on the dirt track, 6 of them made all.
Yeah.
That once they ripped up the dirt, they laid all weather for a few seasons, had an experiment with that, didn't work. Now they've relaid the dirt, and they've certainly worked on it. They've had this little hiatus between their early fall meet and now this little boutique meet for the Breeders' Cup, and it's definitely become more of a level playing field. In the first couple of days, it was definitely playing to speed.
Okay.
But by the end of that short meet, it was far easier for closers to win. Okay. And indeed, one two-year-old came from 30 lengths behind at the start. He completely blew the start and actually won from being behind the leader at halfway 30 lengths. So it is much more even than it was at the start of the meet.
Perfect. Lovely stuff. Right, let's get into the racing then, because we've got a lot to get through. Friday night is Juvenile Night. Of course, signing up with the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Turf Sprint, where we have plenty of familiar names heading the betting. Love Reigns and the Platinum Queen now joint favourites at 7-2. Dramatised is 7-1. Speedboat Beach 8-1. Persian Force 8-1. Mischief Magic 10-1. Tyler's Child 14s. Oxymore 16s. And bigger prices the rest for this opening contest with a strong European challenge. And three horses, of course, met at Royal Ascot. And it's been a cracking year for the juveniles in the UK. So hopefully that will continue with a strong performance on Friday night at Keeneland. Of course, Love Reigns at 7-2 with the Platinum Queen. I'll come to you quickly first, Simon, because a little bit of a market move, unsurprisingly, for the Wesley Ward one. A Dramatised maybe a bit bigger than I was expecting.
Yeah, Dramatised is a fair price. I mean, she's a 7-1 chance. Love Reigns and Platinum Queen are the fancy two, the favourites, 7-2, each of two, which, given Platinum Queen's draw out in 12, is going to be really tough for her. Loads of pace outside there as well, just on her inside. The likes of Sharpers Attack, Tyler's Tribe, Speedboat Beach all get away quickly from the stall. So getting that position for Holly Doll and the Platinum Queen looks like it'll be tough. But she is currently joint favourite and Dramatised a very fair price indeed.
Yeah, and Rachel, you were talking about this race off air and the Platinum Queen. Everything went right at Longchamp. Brilliant ride. Kept going and going on that rail as the Abbey tends to unfold, but going to be a bit of a different proposition. However, Golden Pal managed it from a wide draw, but of course Golden Pal was trained by Wesley Ward, who's going to have a big say.
Yeah, and Golden Pal has proven around a turn. And I know what Richard Fahey has said, that his gallop has a turn, but there's a big difference between a race around a turn and a gallop around a turn.
Yeah.
And you just have to look at some of the Euros who have gone over to run in this particular race in the past, particularly one that Holly Doyle rode, the Mighty Gurkha. I mean, he was drawn one, so he had no excuse not to rail, and he just went straight on. So, I mean, I think the Platinum Queen, particularly with no horses to her outside, she might find it a little bit difficult to get around the turn. There's also a thing that she's run in two group races for her age group. Mm. She's been beaten in both of those. This is against two-year-old. She's not getting 17 and 24 pounds from other rivals. She's getting a few from the boys, but while she's won some decent two-year-old races, she's not won at two-year-old group level.
And
ones have.
She's already finished behind Love Reigns and Dramatised as well, comfortably beating at Royal Ascot.
Exactly.
I know that's a very different proposition.
Yes.
And her blistering speed is not exactly what you want over 5 furlongs on fast ground at Ascot. But 7-2. Is that a popularity price then, maybe? Or just the fact that she comes into it off a Group 1 win?
I think particularly as we're working with British bookmakers and British odds, and particularly you're going to get this factor, particularly with the American punters too. It's the Holly Doyle factor. You know, we always joke the Frankie factor. I think this year at the Breeders' Cup, we're seeing a little bit shorter because simply it's Holly Doyle.
Yeah.
And so we like that, because we're going to play against Holly Doyle's, that sort of thing.
Perfect. Okay, how are you playing against it?
Well, Love Reigns, so I'm going to play the other joint favourite because, you know, this race has been run 4 times. Wes Ward's won it 3.
Yeah.
He's got one runner. The past 3 years, he's had between 3 and 4 runners in each race. He has won. And he's scratched this horse out of the Indian Summer Stakes, which Private Creed actually won, who reopposes in stall 3, so she could train up fresh, because Wesley Ward says that his two-year-olds run better when they don't have that many runs, which is something that the Platinum Queen and Persian Force for Richard Hannon, you don't normally get two-year-olds going into races having 7 runs already. I mean, particularly if they're not trained by Mark Johnston. So Love Reigns going in fresh. It's Wesley Ward. It's Keeneland. She's got the course form. She's drawn brilliantly in 2. Done.
Perfect. There you go. The Willie Mullins bumper approach, I think it's known as Wesley Ward just sends one. Mark, what about you? Are you with Wes Ward as well?
I am indeed. I am indeed. Irad Ortiz Jr. is aboard Love Reigns. We ought to mention that the last four Breeders' Cup, he has been the leading rider in each of those four occasions. He's now had 14 winners. We'll remember him over on this side of the pond for not having a very good Royal Ascot, but he is a very, very good jockey in his own ballpark. Love Reigns is definitely a player. I personally think in a match race between the Platinum Queen and Dramatised, I would much rather be backing Dramatised. And to take another leaf out of another trainer's book, Mr. Carl Burke has taken a leaf out of the Aidan O'Brien book and taken Dramatised to work around the sweeping left-handed turn at Southwell. Ah. And Aidan has tried that on many occasions in the past with quite a bit of success in the past. So, yes, it is only a piece of work, but it was something that's been tried and it's worked in the past. I think Dramatised here could well be, if you like, the little bit of value against the top two in the market. But I'm with Rachel. I think Love Reigns, it's her race to lose.
Okay, lovely. Love Reigns is 7-2 then, and I mean, I don't think he will, but I'd love a Persian Force win to win the Brocklesby and to cap out Simon with the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Turf Sprint. I mean, I'm sure Bill Turner maybe tried it once or twice, but that'd be quite the season, wouldn't it, for Persian Force?
Oh, exactly. Literally bookending the season with their success in Tyrrell races. I mean, look. He's ultra consistent. I think somebody pointed out that it's only Aidan O'Brien that stopped him being a Aidan O'Brien horses that stopped him being a multiple grade one winning horse. Frankie Dettori in the plate, drawn pretty well in six, and he'll certainly be staying on. There's so much pace. I was looking at the way the race sets up. I mean, obviously, Love Reigns will be out quick. Lady Hollywood Dramatised likes to be up the front. And on the outside, there's loads of pace. You can see it being really fast, and that often means that one of the fast horses ends up winning. But if you do think something could come from behind, I thought Mischief Magic probably be held up, could come through horses, and looks a solid each way play. And I imagine Persian Force over this trip will probably be further back and staying on. So they were probably the two each way alternatives for me. That said, I always tend to be attracted to the Europeans. And of course, in this race, I think the Europeans have yet to win it since it became a Breeders' Cup race. But it's the strongest team that assembled. And our In the Know special is just that, actually. Europe to win this race was even money. You get them all at 5-4, which is obviously better than backing them individually. And you get the Platinum Queen, Dramatised, Persian Force, Mischief Magic and Lady Hollywood all running for you. So if you fancy Europe to win, want to keep it simple, 5-4. And you also get the extra place, four places each way.
Lovely stuff. Final word on this race to you, Mark.
If Simon wants a speed Armageddon, he thinks he's going to get it. The other horse very much who comes into the mix is the three-horse Private Creed, trained by Steve Asmussen. He won the Indian Summer, which was the trial that Love Rain scratched out of. They ran a stakes record that day. They went stupidly quick. And Steve is on record as saying, coming into the meet, that he doesn't think that Private Creed could necessarily win the race if it was just run as a steady sprint, if you like. But if they go incredibly hard, he can see Private Creed picking up the pieces and might even fall into this horse's lap. So that's another horse who definitely is going to be suited by an electric pace.
Lovely stuff. Well, but I distinctly remember, in particular last year, Dick saying exactly the same thing as Twilight Gleaming made all, and probably the year before when Golden Pal pretty much made all as well. So there's
and
nothing.
Four-wheel drive in 2019 made all, and Bulletin in 2018 when it first became a Breeders' Cup race. Made all.
Yeah, so it's the worst. The worst thing in horse racing is there's a lot of pace on here because it never ever works out. Or you get one of the previous, you get a front runner on paper who goes, oh, this is nice. I'll just tuck him behind, and a front runner wins it anyway. So, Wesley Ward.
Yeah,
Wesley Ward. Okay, a bit of Love Reigns then, Simon.
Yeah, I'll have Mischief Magic and Persian Force each way, the four places.
Okay, lovely stuff. And I do want Dramatised to win because Carl Beck's had a crack in you with his juveniles and she's very special at Royal Ascot. On the chat, Dramatised will win. Vortex Fitness has backed her anti-post at 16-1, so that's looking good. Peter Davis thinks that the jockeys might, say to Holly Doyle, good luck getting in on the Platinum Queen. And Persian Force looks to have a decent draw and a fair each way bet from Kieran Catterson. So there we go. Good luck, everyone, in that. Moving on then to the next juvenile contest, the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies here. The 7:40 contest on Friday night is on the dirt. In fact, not that that's the mix between turf and dirt. You have half and half. Maybe we should introduce that. I don't know, mix it up, get new fans in. But so we're going to rattle through a few of them fairly quickly. This is going to be one of them. Chop Chop ironically, 7-2, Chocolate Gelato 4-1, Wonder Wheel 5-1, and Tell Me No Lies is 9-1, Raging Sea 10s, You're My Girl 10s, Leave No Trace 10s, Atomically 12s, bigger prices the rest. So let's just get a line from each of the panel on this Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies. Starting off with you, Mark, how did it shape up to you?
It's been run 39 times. This is one of the original races they ran. Remember, this is over the short stretch, so it's only 288 yards from the end of the turn to the winning line, so it's only a furlong and a quarter. Here's a stat for you. Run 38 times. The winner has come out of 29 times, has come out of either the Chandelier at Santa Anita, the Alcibiades at Keeneland, or the Frisette at Belmont, which this year was run at Aqueduct. All three winners are in this race. So we can reduce it from 14 down to 3. The winners either, and Tell Me No Lies, Wonder Wheel, and Chocolate Gelato. For me, course and distance winner, Wonder Wheel is the one for me, representing Tyler Gaffalione and Mark Cassie. Wealth warning, however, about Gaffalione. He is the ultimate donut jockey at the Breeders' Cup. And I will check my statistics here, because he has the biggest donut. It has sugar on top of it and coating. He is currently 0-34 in the Breeders' Cup. No jockey has ridden more races at the Breeders' Cup and not had a winner.
Wow.
And yet I'm prepared to go in with him on Wonder Wheel.
But he has a cracking, absolutely cracking book of rides. Even he's on the French filly in the mile. I mean, they're coming full on. So, you know, I think this might
If it's going to change.
He's not going to get a better chance except this year. But I'm going to piggyback off the back.
Oh, we're throwing the donut at if he doesn't win.
He'll go through the card.
I'm going to bounce off the back of Mark's stats, because it doesn't just have to be winners that have come out of three. It could be placed horses. So Chop Chop, trained by Brad Cox. Last time the Breeders' Cup was at Keeneland, Brad Cox rocked up with four winners, and he won his first Eclipse Award as leading trainer. This one, I think, is one of his best chances. On her debut on the dirt, in the Alcibiades, she finished a nose second, just missing out from Wonder Wheel, who refused to change leads and looked like absolute stare, and more was going up and down on the spot than forward, whereas she was absolutely cruising through the field. The problem is she missed the kick. She's a turf horse, and as trainer Brad Cox said, she just sort of stumbled and got a little wheel spin coming out. She'll be a lot sharper this time. And if she can do that with a short stretch, make up 8 1/4 lengths turning in, if she's just a little bit closer, she's going to win this.
Okay, there you go. Chop Chop is 7-2 favourites. Simon, wrap us up with a quick summary of this one.
I think Rachel's right. If you watch that Alcibiades, it was a really competitive race, and Chop Chop came from miles back. Wonder Wheel had the run of the race, and I think Chop Chop, presumably named after Jorge Chavez, Chop Chop Chavez, a very good jockey, had a nickname. I think it was due to his whip style, I imagine. But so Chop Chop for me, Brad Cox, Joel Rosario, to beat Tyler Gaffalione and keep him on the snide.
Okay, there we go. All right. Okay, plenty of opinions then in the Juvenile Fillies. Wonder Wheel and Tell Me No Lies reverse forecast for Graham Harris. Why not? Why not? Why not box them up, Graham? Good luck. Good luck with that one. The Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies Turf is next up. Again, another, or at least on our page, we've got a European strong favourite in the shape of Meditate, who's currently 11-4. Delight is 6-1. Free Luck is 15-2. Pleasant Passage 8-1. Spirit Gal, another interesting Irish Raider, is 10-1. Midnight Mile for Richard Fahey, who could be in fantastic mood or cursing that draw by the time we get to 8:20. We'll see tomorrow night. Last Call is 14-1, and it's 16-1 and bigger the rest. 14 of them go to post. And of course, Meditate, we've seen plenty of times again. Another very heavily raced two-year-old this season, which certainly hasn't been a bad thing for Ballydoyle, with the likes of Blackbeard in particular having a very good year. And Meditate beaten by two very talented horses on her last two starts. Even with her winning running coming to an end, you can certainly look at Lazoo and Tahira and say we might well have been beaten by some very smart horses. But Delight looks a decent one, the best horse to come out of Mendelssohn's early crop as well. And Spirit Gal, Midnight Mile, bringing a bit of European interest as well. Rachel, what did you make of this?
Well, the first thing about this race, stats race.
Yeah.
It's been run 14 times. Europe, 2. North America, 12.
Yeah.
This one's staying home.
And it's been, what, a decade since Europe won it as well, was it? Was it Flotilla 2000?
It was Cressilium.
Ah, was it? Was it? Oh, yeah, it was. Yeah, of course, yeah. It was two on the bounce, wasn't it? It was Flotilla and then Cressilium. Yeah.
And also, the other stat, all the winners all previous 14 of them have raced over a mile more. Only Flotilla didn't win over a mile. She won over seven, but she had previously raced over a mile. So if you believe that stat, Spirit Gal, Manhattan Jungle, Meditate, Midnight Mile, and Basil Martini. None of the Euros can win.
Okay,
so
done. Enough.
So best of the Americans is Delight. As you said, she was Mendelssohn, who won the boys' version of this race in 2017. Best runner. She took the course and distance trial, the grade two Jessamine. And she not just took it, she dragged it out by five lengths in absolutely phenomenal fashion. Ears doing this the entire way. She's trained by Jonathan Thomas, who's a former assistant of Todd Pletcher. So, you know, he knows how to win these sort of things. And Louis Saez is currently the reigning champion jockey of Keeneland.
Okay.
Is aboard. So that's it. That's easy. Trial winner wins this.
Yeah. I mean, the confidence. The confidence. So far, we've done three races and Rachel's, you know, going through the card already with this confidence. I like it. Delight, 6-1. Yeah, it makes you think why the European challengers out of the Phillies Mile don't go for it if you have to have been proven over this for this trip. But yeah, the likes of Spirit Gal, Meditate, and in particular, Midnight Mile's a bit of an interesting one, but I didn't think it was a particularly good race. It was a bit of a pace collapse. I mean, she should improve for the mile, but especially with juveniles, yeah, being tested, that extra pain barrier really does come into it at a race of this quality.
I think as well, when you're going two turns on turf in the United States, a horse who's going into a race like that, maybe on their second or third start like Midnight Mile, they're much more hardened to it in the States than they might be having run over the wide open plains of Newmarket. I just think the actual two-year-olds and the early two-year-olds who haven't have had much experience, I think this all becomes a much, much more different kind of thing they have to do.
Yeah.
There are lies, damn lies, and then there are statistics. We've had loads of statistics already.
I mean, I love it. I'm glad you're here, because it's normally my job. This is great.
Listen, if we were talking about American football, we would have put 3,000 more stats in already than we are in this. We've got to talk Aidan O'Brien. We've got to talk not the Aidan O'Brien of bygone era, but the Aidan O'Brien of the here and now. This race, 0-15, placed four times.
Yeah.
In the last four Breeders' Cup series, Aidan O'Brien 1-38, 0-6 last year. Aidan O'Brien now ain't Aidan O'Brien then.
Yeah. You think his priorities shifted a bit as well with the races
he
goes for?
I think so, yeah. And you've got to factor that into how you play the races. For me, I think Delight is the most likely winner and the only previous course runner in the field as well, it ought to be mentioned. If you like horses coming into races out of key preps, the key prep over the years for this race has been the Miss Grillo, won by a horse called Pleasant Passage, trained by Hall of Famer Shug McGahey. That's the five horse Pleasant Passage, ridden by Arad Ortiz Jr. We're going to keep mentioning his name over and over again because he's got a live mount in every race in the series. I really like the way that she knuckled down to winning the Miss Grillo. And the interesting thing was, I'm always drawn to a Miss Grillo winner in this race to either win or place because they tend to run well. But it was her tenacity and the way that she did it. She got eyeballed and she kicked and she wanted it. And Shug McGahey is one of those great old-fashioned trainers in the United States whose horses, when they have a heart and an engine, they're very hard to pass. I wouldn't say they're like a Mark Johnston horse, but it's that similar kind of profile. And I really like her. I think she's an each-way price.
Is that, I mean, this is another race, though, where you do look at it and you think, oh, a bit of pace. Oh, there's a bit of pace there. Oh, and
that's the worry.
Yeah.
That's the worry.
Because, you know, Delight's going to go there, Pleasant Passage. Obviously, Spirit Gal, potentially, there's a few more. It's, but as I said in the previous preview, the betting after furlong will be very different.
Yeah, but that's the great thing about this. Just look at the two American fillies we've talked about. Delight, yeah, she made all the running, but because nobody went forward. Last time, she sat off the pace. On Pleasant Passage's debut, she was fifth when they first started, and she weaved her way through. I mean, that's the great thing with these. We don't necessarily know that. I think the run style is just going to be dictated on how they jump. Right. But, I mean, this would be definitely a race where, you know, the Aidan O'Brien stat, the stat that she's never won over a mile before. I mean, also, to give him his... Let's put it in context. If we have ever heard of horses, the likes of Mother Earth, September, Happily, Alice Springs, Hydrangea, Roly Poly qualified together, Lily Langtry, they all lost this.
Yeah.
So it's not like he's not brought the good ones.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and this, last year's race was a... It was one of the races of the meeting. Mm-hmm. I thought it looked at some point. I mean, previously we talked about it and we thought there's loads of European challenges, plenty of American challenge, and obviously Pizza Bianca weaved a passage through from that one box. And it looks lively again on paper this year, Simon.
Oh, it does. I mean, I was looking back. I mean, to be fair, things like Mother Earth, Alice Springs have both come second. I think Europe has come second in 5 of the last 7 runnings of this. So although they've got beat, and that stat 2 from 14 is favouring the Americans, the Europeans haven't been that far away. I think they've been placed pretty much every year with one of their runners. He says, talking up is in the no special, obviously, because we're offering 5-4 a European winner of the Juvenile Fillies Turf this year from Even Money. You get plenty running for you, the likes of Meditate, Spirit Gal, Midnight Mile, Basil Martini and Manhattan Style. I think I normally always back the Aidan O'Brien runner in this race because I've convinced myself that this year he's gonna do it with one of his fillies. And I keep looking at Meditate and wondering whether that 7 furlong speed is perfect for the mile. By No Name Never, honestly, top class, you know, beaten twice in grade ones. But I know you're shaking your head, Mark. I will get drawn into backing up Irad Ortiz Jr. I was sort of picking up the last couple of years on his amazing strike rate at the Breeders' Cup. And the advantage he has on Pleasant Passage against the other horse who like to go forward is he's on the inside of those horses. So whatever happens, he should be able to secure a lovely position, even if others come around her. And I think Pleasant Passage looks solid each way. I wondered whether, and you probably know better than me, Mark, Be Your Best was really well fancied in the Miss Griot. The ground was yielding that day and she didn't run that badly. She's 16-1. I just like that form. And I just wondered whether maybe on a slightly firmer turf, you know, you could chuck a few quid at her each way and she might bounce back to the best from her previous start. But those are the ones I'm looking at.
The other thing there, Simon, as well, because it's the trainer's first ever runner in the Breeders' Cup series, not that well known. You're factoring that into the price, therefore that this isn't, if you like, a sexy horse. It's the other Ortiz brother riding, the one who's not so high profile. I totally agree with you as well. The ground was absolutely rattling at Saratoga for the first two starts. It probably was against her last time, although the surface does look rather loose at Keeneland. Yeah, although it's quite firm, it does look as though the horses are struggling to get a little bit of purchase on the track, even when they're going around the dogs when they're working. But I agree with you, there's a lot of upside which you can factor into a horse like that, maybe given those factors.
Okay, there we go, yeah. Be Your Best is what price, Simon?
Be Your Best is 20-1.
Okay.
Oh, 16-1. So 16-1. Been nibbled into. Must have been backed after I tipped it.
That's it. You move markets, Simon. You move markets. What can I say? The Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies Turf. Let's get the selections on the chat before we get the panel to sum that up. Graham Harris, Spirit Gal could well win a good race, but Meditate looks the winner. Pleasant Passage has a very good attitude, says Peter Davis. What else have we got? A couple more as well. Dante 44 says Delight and Pleasant Passage. Going for a couple there. And Meditate, surely a must, says the Braddy G. But sounds like everyone's taking on Meditate in the studio and at home with Simon. So, Rachel, what are you backing?
Delight
it is.
Pleasant Passage each way for me.
There you go, lovely. And Simon?
I'll probably Pleasant Passage and be Your Best each way, but I'll probably end up having a few quid on Meditate, because I just will.
Okay, fair enough. Penultimate race on Friday then is the Breeders' Cup Juvenile with one of the warmest, I mean, depending, take Flight Line out of it, and definitely the warmest favourite of the weekend, the Shape of Cave Rock, who's a 4-6 shot. Forte is 7-2. National Treasure, 15-2. Blazing Sevens, 8-1. 18-1. Verifying Curly Jack, 25s. Lost Ark, 40s. Hurricane J is 50-1. But Cave Rock, this Son of Arrogate, has been mightily impressive in 3 starts to date, and is a very warm favourite to continue his winning run. But Forte is not too far behind the market leader in terms of overall ability, and obviously has, as we've been discussing, a cracking trainer jockey combination there, and a couple of others who've shown a bit of form as well. Blazing Sevens, that run last time out, wasn't far off the normal quality needed to win a race of this nature. So the question is, we had a couple of horses similar to last year. I get the feeling occasionally, especially with a Baffert horse every now and then, a horse performs like that last time out. They come into a race like this at the Breeders' Cup and people go, yeah, easy, it'll happen again. We know exactly how it's going to unfold. You're not entirely convinced that the prices should be this far apart.
Oh, no, not at all. I mean, this is just Baffert money. He is a record 5-times winner of the race, and, you know, a lot of people just go, let's find the Californian freak. It's trained from the right trainer, and it's wearing the right colors in the silks of owners Mike Pegram and Carl Watson, who have had so many horses, good horses, More Than Ready, etc., with Bob Baffert. But I just was not convinced by his 5-length win in the Grade 1 American Pharaoh. I mean, one, he beat 3 of his stablemates, and I don't think the second tried very hard. The second's back in National Treasure with the blinkers back on. But, I mean, he was a bit scratchy going into the first turn. He was still a bit headstrong. He was doing a lot wrong. And you can't do anything wrong and win this race. Forte was a lot more professional to me when winning the Breeders' Futurity over course and distance. He has that short stretch experience. And I know he only won by a neck. And he was hanging into the winner a little bit. But I liked how he rattled Ortiz Jr. Actually had to stop riding him, pull him off. He actually went down by about a half a head and then rallied to get back up for the win. I thought that was a very professional piece of racing. And what we do like is on the Stars of Tomorrow Day at Churchill Downs on Saturday night, the horse who finished 7th in the Breeders' Futurity, 2 Fills, well, came out and won the street sense. So, you know, there is solidity of form with the horses that he beat.
Okay. So, I mean, this is looking like, I mean, absolute each-way thievery then, isn't it? Put it all in all.
Well, not at 7-2.
4-6 favourite. I think I mean, Simon, how much can I have on 7-2 each way against a 4-6 favourite? What are you laying me?
I don't know where your stakes are.
Yeah, fair enough. But I'm not averse to an each way play at 7-2.
Free bet, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think all of us here in the studio like Forte, but again, we have to remember this is over the short stretch, and this is if he is going to win, we are going to need a couple of horses to get involved on the front end. It's likely to happen. I think it will happen. But you certainly want Cave Rock softened up with a couple of jabs so you can land the real pile drive where they come into the home straight. Forte, I like his profile. I like everything he's done. I'm giving a pass for the fact that I thought he took a little bit of time to get going when he won 2 starts back at Saratoga, because he got a bit of wheel spin on a horrible sloppy track. He then took a bump and he still managed to guts it out and win. He was far more impressive when he won last time at Keeneland. I think he is the most likely winner, personally, not Cave Rock. But I wouldn't want him to go much shorter than he is at the moment. This is actually quite a deep race, and I think you can make. I mean, I didn't even have this horse on my radar until I started reading one or two of the track watchers and some of the reports. But there's a horse at a huge price, the one horse, Hurricane J. He comes here on the back of a maiden special weight win by a nose and then an AOC, an announced optional claimer, here at Keeneland, both in sprints over 6 furlongs. But the people who've seen this horse actually at the track are saying he is one of the knockout 2-year-olds that they've seen. He's one of the best looking and best moving horses on the dirt of anything in the entire series. So he's getting really well talked up. And
could he be a bit of a spoiler as well in terms of that early speed?
What does Joe Talamo do? That's the thing. I agree with you. He's got to send him from one, hasn't he?
Yeah,
I mean, he's
got
no option. I would have thought that Paulo Lobo, who trains him, was probably praying he'd get 4, 5, 6 in the gate. And when he pulled the one pill, I should imagine he took a pill.
Yeah.
Because that is just where you didn't want to be. Because Talamo's got to send.
Yeah.
He has to send.
It's all or nothing, isn't it, from
that? From one. And in this race, with such a short run to the first turn, less than half furlong to the first turn and the short stretch, if you have the inside seat, you've got to use it.
Just talk to me about Blazing Sevens, who, if it is a bit loose and they do go a fair old clip, that win last time out should set Blazing Sevens up for a decent performance. And again, clockwise, it looked good enough to get involved.
Clockwise, it did, but it was an awful track.
Yeah.
The Aqueduct track took a real pasting that championship day. I'm wondering whether any of the form from that particular day. Mm. Belmont at the Big A, it's called. So if anybody looks at the PPs, you're expecting to see BEL for Belmont. It's actually now BAQ, and it's not, they didn't have a barbecue. It was Belmont at the Big A, because they're currently building a basketball stadium next door, so they've closed the track down for 6 months. It was horrible, horrible ground. I'm a little worried that form reads better on paper than it really is. The one good thing about him, His dad won this race back in 2017, so it runs in the family. He's legitimate in a deep race. He's legitimate, but I have a huge question mark about the solidity of the form.
Okay, Simon, any thoughts in this Cave Rock 4-6 house? As I get, how do punters play these kind of horses at a meeting like this? Is it do they avoid them entirely, or are they going to be lining up with me and trying to each way three, 4-8, 7-2? What are you expecting?
Well, I can tell you now, 4-2 is now 4-1. So,
Well, there you go. I mean, it's not only you that moves markets, Simon. What could I say?
I know, you move. I think there's various ways. I think obviously playing forecasts and trifectas and stuff. Our in the nose special is interesting, actually, given that Cave Rock has won by 5.25 lengths, 5.25 lengths, and 6 lengths. Well, you can back Cave Rock to win by over 2.5 lengths at 11-4, and he's trading at 4-6 at the moment. I've got to say, that's quite generous. That's out from 2-1. It's almost a boom or bust horse, isn't it? I mean, if he gets an uncontested lead and runs freakily, he could win by 4 or 5, and you get paid out 11-4. But if you look back at the beaten favourites in the juvenile, a lot of times they don't even hit the board when they get beat. They're out the back of the telly. So almost if you're going to back Cave Rock, I'd almost be tempted to back it at the end of no special rather than take odds on, if that makes sense. And but you know, the guys have set it up nicely. I think Forte is a very solid alternative. I'd half wondered. Interesting about that track in the Champagne. Verifying was only a 9-4 chance that day. Obviously came second to Blazing Sevens, was it? I just, you know, again, at a big price, you know, back on a more traditional, you know, dry dirt track, and just thought Verifying each way at 18-1, just searching out a little bit of value each way. But a hard race to have a confident bet on, for sure.
Okay. Cave Rock is 4-6, though. You'll be taking him on, Rachel?
Yep, with Forte.
Forte it is. Mark?
Forte for me.
Forte it is. That's 3-for-4 in the studio. What about you, Simon?
If I could, I'd back the In The Know special, but I can't, so I'm not allowed to bet with Coral. So I'm going to have a throwaway outsider bet on Verifying for Brad Cox.
OK, 18-1 for Verifying then. Last race on the Friday night card is the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Turf. Again, with familiar challenges at the top of the betting, headed by Silver Knot for Charlie Appleby, who loves this race. He's won it 3 times in the past 10 years, and Silver Knot with that win at Newmarket last time out. Certainly brought the level of quality taken to win this race. 5-4 favourite, though, so you're not getting too much juice out of the price, albeit the only race that Silver Knot has lost were won by Chaldine. So the form is rock solid. Victoria Road is 7-1, and the winner is 8-1. I'm Very Busy, 9-1. Pax of Wallop is 9-1. Major Dude is 12-1. Nedja Rock is 14s. Web Slinger is 20s, and bigger prices the rest. Mark, I'll come to you first for this, because if there's one man you're saying about the Aidan O'Brien of old, well, it's partly because Charlie Appleby's playing at his own game and doing it even better. He can send horses... Well, you name it, he'll send them there and he'll win races. And Silver Knot looks the ideal candidate compared to his previous winners.
He does. Appleby and O'Brien between them have got 7 wins in this race as well. O'Brien 4 and Appleby 3. I don't know. I really don't know what to make of it. I think this is almost the race I've got least real positive vibes about.
Okay.
So I'm waiting to be swayed by everyone else here. Silver Knot, I'm confused by, because I called him when he won the Solario at Sandown. And I thought for much of that race, he wasn't going to do what he did at the end of that race. And I don't know. I'm not sure whether this horse actually will. I think the key to Silver Knot, and I don't know whether you would agree, is what he does in the middle part and the final turn. That key part where American races develop around the top turn. I'm not sure how electric his positioning speed is. Tactical speed, if you like.
Well, it seemed to be at Newmarket, it was a kind of just a relentless gallop. He just kept going and going and going, and he got into a lovely rhythm. Like he did at Sandown, like you said.
Yeah.
They parted.
Yes.
And you thought, oh, he's not really taking off. And then he just kept going. But he has got... I know, obviously, he's playing American jockeys in his backyard, but, I mean... Can Buick do any wrong?
No.
So, if anyone's going to get him in the right position to attack...
Oh, I agree.
He's going to be really
good. He'll be in the right place.
Yeah.
It's just whether the horse can do it.
Yeah, fair.
I think he's going to get a little bit of help, because Victoria Road, Pax Wallop, Curly Larry and Moe, drawn 1, 2, 3, they'll go forward.
Yeah.
And Buick can just... Thank you.
Yeah.
And just... Even
find that position that Buick always seems to
exactly.
find.
Yeah.
Is
where
you think... What he needs... Oh, he's there. He's taken that gap.
Yeah. I mean, because the... You look more to the outside, that's where a lot of the closers are.
Yeah.
And so he's sort of the pace horse closest to the speed horses on the inside. I mean, actually, if they could have drawn this the best, I mean, Silver Knot just going, well, thank you.
Yeah, that's exactly what they would have picked. Victoria Road's a tough one because, again, a lot of the Ballydoll juveniles we've seen impress at the, you know, the likes of your Uni Markets, your Currers, your Doncasters, obviously a week or two ago. Mm. Victoria Road, you'd have had to go back and watch them replay some Deauville Ashanti, Rachel, because, yeah, I almost had to double check. I was like, oh, right, okay. He hadn't necessarily been on my radar.
Yeah. No, he hadn't, because he's been running more in France than we would have seen him over here, but he's coming here on the back of three straight wins. This is a race you want to follow Aiden in, because he's the record holder in it. He's won four times. Mm. Mr. Moore has ridden four of them, conversely, the same horses. And it's ironic that they've gone for the Prix de Condre over 9 furlongs at Chantilly for the final prep, because Mr. Charlie Appleby used that with Line of Duty a couple of years ago as his final prep.
And in contrast to what you're saying about Meditate, they've guaranteed that stamina here.
And the one thing with him is, if he can have the speed to break from one, because his run style is he does tend to go more prominently placed, with Paxawal up to his outside, there's only one thing Ryan can do with him, and that is send.
Yeah.
The one thing we know he stays is 9 furlongs. So, you know, if you're Ryan, and I'm never going to aspire to try and tell Ryan Moore what to do, I'm just going to try and send him and just know I can outstay most of these as long as I can keep going. Because okay. I think some of the likes of the Packs of Wallop and Curly Larry and Mo, well, we're not convinced with their quality in a race like this.
Okay.
Is he fast enough, though, to win this race? Is he actually a fast enough horse?
Don't think so, but got to try.
Fair enough. Is there anything else we should be keeping
And the winner is will be the quickest of the closers.
That's such an annoying name, by the way. How annoying. When you said that, I was expecting you to tell me the winner. Every time
I am doing. And the winner is.
I spoke to someone earlier and said, "Oh, you know, are you watching the Breeders' Cup?" And he said, "I'm very busy." And I said, well, great, okay, thanks for letting me know. And he's like, that's my one bet for the weekend, is I'm very busy. So, yeah. I'm very busy and the winner is. It's almost virtual racing in the some of the American names.
I think as Rach said, there's a lot of speed to the inside and the outside of the gate, there come the closers. And I think that, and the winner is, if you like, has got the most tactical speed and the most effective tactical speed of the closers. So I think he'll get first run on anything else coming from a mile back. Wayne Castellano, 4 wins in the series, lifetime, 3 of them in juvenile races. Oscar Performance, the sire, won this race at Santa Anita in 2016. There's just a lot to like. He's also a dual Keeneland winner, and there aren't many of those running at this year's Breeders' Cup. Yeah. I just thought he had a bit more juice in the price. I think the most likely winner is Silver Knot. I don't want to pay the price to see him win. I'd rather try and eke a little bit of value out of the rest.
Okay, and the winner is then, unbeaten here and hasn't won elsewhere, so could well be the angle at 8-1. Simon, sum us up with your last race on Friday, please.
Yeah, 4 places each way, which given we've got a fight for favourite isn't bad. And we are offering the Euro winner in this, which again, actually, all three of these in the nose specials for a European winner at the same price, 5-4 from even money. And that effectively means you get Silver Knot, who is 5-4, and means you get Victoria Road chucked in free for 7-1. So pretty better off back in that special than Silver Knot at the moment. The horse, I'm very busy. I just watched the breakfast at the Breeders' Cup, which I think has been fantastic every day this week. The Breeders' Cup show or the TVG show. And Flavian Pratt, when asked, you know, he's obviously riding Flightline on Saturday, but when he was asked for another horse he was really looking forward to running, he was, I'm very busy. He was second to the Pilgrim, odds on. It was, again, that yielding surface. And he just said he thinks that, you know, he's working really well, he expects a big run at 9-1. Chad Brown, I thought he might be a decent each way bet. And the other one, I always have a second glance at Graham Motion runners at the Breeders' Cup. He's got a good record. He picks his fights well. And the fact they're taking Nagirock here, when he's got the six furlong form, and yet he's going, they were adamant this is the right race for Nagirock, and he's going to stay well, and he's coming off a decent, you know, winning form. I thought 14-1 each way. So I'll take on the Europeans here. The Silver Knot just looks too short, even with Charlie Appleby's record.
I'll be told by our producer as well, Simon, you've got a across-the-board juvenile special somewhere there.
Yes, we have. Okay, well man. Done them, yes.
There you
doesn't
go.
Just happen. Good lads. This is for the Friday night. 2 or more European winners on the Friday night, which effectively means across the 3 turf races, 6-5, from 10 to 11. So you think we're going to land at least two European victories on the Friday night, 6 to 5.
Okay, Rachel is taking the Tom Siegel approach here of mocking that special one. Shaking her head next to me. No,
we need
We do need that. We do, we do,
we
do.
We need contention.
There's too much positivity in it. Where's get some cynicism on the line. The selection for the last race on Friday, Mark?
It'll be the winner is.
Okay, there you go. And the winner is, Rachel?
Silver Knot. If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Okay, there you go. Simon?
I'm very busy, Ross. I'm very busy. And,
sorry, mate. Sorry for interrupting. I apologise.
And Nagarok each way too. Two each way bets. Nagarok and I'm very busy.
Okay, lovely stuff. You are a major dude, Simon. What can I say? moving on to Saturday then, which we've got to rattle through. This is the thing with the good races. You could just talk forever on them. But 3:50 at Keeneland. A very respectable time to get involved tomorrow on Saturday for the first race we're going to have a look at on Saturday's card. Again, very short line on this one because we've got a lot to get through. But the Breeders' Cup Filly and Mare Sprint is headed by Goodnight Olive at 3-1, CC 9-2, Echo Zulu 11-2, Frank's Roquette 8, Obligatory 8, Slammed is 9s, Edgeway 14s, 16s, and Bigger the Rest. And we might not have to say too much on this because I believe our panelists are in agreement about a horse who, of course, was a Breeders' Cup winner last year, coming back for another bite.
Yeah, and horse number 13, Echo Zulu. She won the Fillies Juvenile last year, and to be honest, she was going to be the absolute nap of the meeting in this race until she just stall 13 of 13, and now she's just a solid win bet at the price. I wouldn't necessarily say nap, but she is the outside speed. She's the fastest horse in this race, and 7 furlong suits her absolutely down to the ground.
Okay, lovely. Still, there you go. Echo Zulu, 11-2. The back of that impressive win last time out, Mark?
Yeah, the top three in the market are very similar fillies, and therefore the best price of the three is Echo Zulu. I love the quote from Steve Asmussen when describing the chance of Echo Zulu, who, after all, has won 6 of her 7 career starts are in defeat, coming in the Kentucky Oaks when she tried to go 2 turns. She tried to go long in American terms. And he said, we spent a long time trying to get her to do something that she's probably not that good at. Let's go back and do something that she's brilliant at. I think Echo Zulu wins.
Okay, Echo Zulu playing to her strengths then in the Filly and Mare Sprint. Simon?
Oh, yeah, listen, I love Goodnight Olive, Irad Ortiz Jr., Chad Brown. You know, a string of ones by a name and a nice break as well. She's nice and fresh. So she's favourite, unoriginal, but 3-1, Goodnight Olive will do for me.
Okay, Goodnight Olive is quick selection. Dante is also in agreement with Echo Zulu. And Off-World says CC has a big chance, of course, coming back to try and win this for the second year on the bounce. Moving on then, beautiful summarisation of that race. Let's hope it all works out. The Breeders' Cup Turf Sprint is up next, where Golden Pal, who is your pal if you back him in America, but he's very much your enemy if you back him when he comes over to these shores. He's 15-8 favourite. Highfield Princess, probably horse of the year for me personally, certainly popularity-wise as well as performance-wise, is 5-2. Campanelli is 10-1, Creative Force 11-1, Emirati Anna is 14s, Casa Creed 16s, Dancing Book 16s, Arrest Me Red is 16s, and it is bigger prices the rest than far this Breeders' Cup Turf Sprint, with plenty of familiar names, and obviously another Wesley Ward favourite here in the shape of Golden Pal, who, how many times have I talked about this horse in races and either opposed him heavily, thinking he's got absolutely no chance, or looking at him and thinking, how the hell is anyone going to beat him? He's 15-8 to take this race like he did last season, although he's up against a whole host of European challengers, in particular Highfield Princess, who's, you just love it. I've got a bit Kevin Keegan there, but I would just love it. I would love it if the Breeders' Cup Turf Sprint went back to Yorkshire, and not just for my own, Yorkshire blood, but also because she's just been incredible this year.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, I was lucky enough to call her home in the Coral All-Weather Championship final at Newcastle.
And I believe on the day you said she's going to win 3 Group 1s.
As they went through the line, I was coming for ITV, and I think I did say she's won that like a group horse of the future.
Oh, I mean,
that was probably one of my best pieces of work.
Going to see if that's true by playing back the end of the ring.
Simon, what price would Golden Pal be if Highfield Princess wasn't in this race?
Yeah, good point. I mean, but a lot shorter. It'd be even money. Probably.
Get your calculator out, Simon.
Yeah, I was trying to work out. Take 28% of the bet. But listen, no, you're absolutely right. I mean, the Highfield Princess makes the market. It's a classic matchup. I think Golden Power's probably worth taking on. I mean, it looks like, you know, the European Challenge last year when Golden Power was amazing, impressive, was a case of you, Glass Slippers and Emirati Anna. You'd say with Highfield Princess alone, we've got a much better contender this year, and even with Creative Force in there as well, you know, and we still got and a few others like Noble Brown, Gomez Go. So, and there's loads of pace on in the race as well. I know Golden Pile's really fast, may well be out front, even alongside all the other leaders, but he got a very easy lead last year. And I wonder whether it'd be quite as easy this year, which might set it up for something coming from just behind him. But it's a brilliant race.
Mm. Yeah, and it's Golden Power, of course, isn't it? He's 4 from 4 here. There's a lot of pace on here, this pace and then there's pace.
When he won over course and distance in a race called the Shaker Town, on officially good ground, not even on firm, on good ground, he clicked off a first quarter of 20.9, 20 4/5 seconds. There isn't another horse currently in the universe who'd be able to live with that kind of pace. I mean, he just checks every box. And throw into the fact that you have him in 8, which is a good draw because he didn't want to be too inside. He can actually be the outside speed. He can come over the top of Highfield Princess. And guess what? Just to rough her up on the inside, you've got Frankie Dettori riding for his old mate Wesley Ward on Campanelle, who's also an extremely slick four-legged beastie coming out of stall number 4. I mean,
and no stranger to a bit of argy-bargy as well, given the Dragon Symbol race.
Absolutely. I mean, I'm sorry, it's not the sexy thing to take on Highfield Princess, but I would take her on any day of the week. If they ran this race 100 times, I'd always be with Golden Pal.
Okay, he's just one of those horses, isn't he? Part of me, I never want to be with him, but in this kind of race, he's just, well, we know what he's going to do. He's going to break them, in theory, anyway, isn't he?
Well, he is, or he isn't. Because I'm like, here's the fence, and I'm just solidly in the middle of it.
Absolutely
no, I mean, fine. I just mean he's going to win. I mean, that's just by how far. But when he came back after Royal Ascot and won the Troy at Saratoga, he actually laid up with the pace. He didn't set it. He laid up with it. He showed a new dimension.
He was showing off.
He raided a little bit.
Yeah,
and then he kicked on and won. But you know, it's just I don't think he has to lead. I think he's just never really found horses faster than him before. And I mean, there is a thing when Wesley Ward won the turf sprint with him last year at Del Mar, he wrangled basically Coolmore, who own him, and just begged them to give him one more year to come back to win this race for a third time, to become only the third rate horse in history to have won 3 Breeders' Cup races, to put him up there with the likes of Beholder and Goldikova, make proper history. We know Coolmore like historic stallions.
Yeah.
He's going to Ashford literally the next day, so he's done. But this entire thing has been built with winning this again. I know they wanted to go to Royal Ascot to try and get an international sort of audience for him at stud. I think he already had an international audience for him at stud, given who's going to stand him. But this year, this has been the plan. Last year, Royal Ascot was the plan. This year, Royal Ascot was just a blip in the plan to get to here. So, he wins. But, you know, Disney could come calling with Highfield Princess if she wins too. So there you go.
Yeah, and what I remember when she ran at York and she said, as they were going to the gates, I was talking to Paul Keighley and I said, the big question again, that's that first furlong. If she gets on the heels of the Platinum Queen, she wins. She will win. That's the only question. And she has answered that question and then some at both York and the Curragh. So it will be really interesting because if they do turn into the straight and Golden Pal is up there with Highfield Princess swinging along in behind, it's going to be fascinating. And what do we make of the? You have to mention two others: Creative Force, who things haven't really
too
gone to
slow.
Plan. Well, yeah, that's the thing, isn't it? And from one,
yeah, too slow. From one.
Yeah,
very good horse, very nice horse, rounding back into a bit of form. This is 5. Let's also remind ourselves: 5.5 for a long sprint.
Yeah.
Not 6 up a hill.
It's a very different proposition.
Huge difference.
Yeah.
So.
Albeit, they'll be frustrated because he got outstayed last time and he'll get outspeeded this time.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, if you had two horses in the race as the same ownership group and you could switch your post positions, Charlie Appleby and Godolphin would switch Naval Crown and Creative Force. So Creative Force from 9, much more interesting proposition, but he's drawn 1, so no, put a line through it.
Okay. If you wanted to sit back, And I know it's only at 4:29 in the afternoon, so it may still be a mug of your chamomile tea rather than something a bit stronger.
No, it won't.
And you just wanted to watch Highfield Princess and Golden Power, but not watch it with a vested interest. You could do far worse than having a little nibble at Emirati Anna.
Okay.
You could run a very good race. Fourth in the race last year at Del Mar. Took a long time to get over a thwarted trip to Dubai.
Yeah.
Didn't travel that well there. Didn't take to the everything over in Dubai. Has just started to really show an upward curve in the form.
Yeah.
Likes this kind of ground. You've drawn Ryan Moore now on Emirati Anna because Andrea Zini's not got the job with Sheikh Obaid anymore. And stall three isn't a bad place for Emirati Anna to stalk the pace early and stay on. I thought maybe in a place market or in an each way, it's difficult to see winning, so maybe more to maybe get in a place or something. I think Emirati Anna's will run a decent race.
Do we have four places in this one, Simon, for a bit of each way Emirati
Anna? We do. We do have four places, yeah. We're offering 6-5 the In the Know Special, a European winner, which doesn't sound like the panel are going to be jumping all over that with the Highfield Princess and Creative Force and Emirati Anna. No, okay. But I think, you know, so I wrote down here sort of Golden Pal wins, really. But one horse I thought was ginger, I was sort of trying to look for angles. There's always loads of pace in a race this quick. Casa Creed is quite a classy horse. He's obviously got Group 1 form over a mile, but he's got two wins over 6 furlongs. Great tough traveller. Went to Saudi Arabia and Maidan. And in a race where maybe there'll be loads of horses trying to chase down Golden Pal, he can sit in behind and finish strong and come through. And, you know, if you're playing, you know, sort of trifectas or exactas, you could chuck him in at 16-1 because he could be a sort of solid horse. And certainly with the four places, might be worth an each way bet, particularly if Golden Pal did blow out. But yeah, just trying to search for angles, really. But I thought Casa Creed might be interesting.
Okay, Casa Creed is a 16-1 shot then. Okay, how are we playing this, Rachel?
Golden Pal.
Golden Pal it is, Mark.
Golden Pal win, Emirati Anna to place.
OK, I'll be backing Golden Pal to win and laying him to place, because it's either one or the other, isn't it? And Simon?
Yeah, I'll have Casa Creed each way, and I'll probably end up backing Golden Pal. I think he just probably will win, won't he?
Well, not if you're Ian Wicks on the chat, who thinks we've gone absolutely stark raving mad the way we've been talking about Golden Pal, so... It's a game of opinions, as they say, Ian. You don't think much of ours based on what you've been saying about that. Let's get on to and rattle through this big-ass fans Breeders' Cup Dirt Mile, then.
Sorry, who were the sponsors?
I think it's big-ass fans, I believe, is the correct pronunciation. And we've got Laurel River and Cody's Wish, 11-4 joint favourites here. Cyberknife, 7-2. 11-2, Goodnight, 12-1, and bigger the rest. Again, this is one of those ones we're going to be short and sweet with. But interesting money for Laurel River, who I was going to say comes from a beautiful family, but of course, Laurel River comes from a beautiful family, given the connections. Cyberknife dropping in grade. Cody's Wish improved last time out. Rachel, how are you playing it?
Cyberknife. He's the progressive 3-year-old that they're dropping back down in trip. He won the Grade 1 Haskell, beating some solid horses that we're going to see running in the Classic later on. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that's it. Brad Cox, great record. Cyberknife, he's the angles playing here.
Okay, yeah, he's not going up against Epicenter, that's for sure, who might well have a big say in a potential upset later on the card. What do you make of it, Mark?
Laurel River, wealth warning. Uncle Bob Baffert, 0-10 in this race, and not one of his 10 runners has even been placed.
Oh, okay.
So that is a real worry about him. Don't like him, don't like Cody's Wish, because all his wins are one turn. Goodnight, I think, is quite a legitimate horse, but Cyberknife is one I come down on again. I think he'll probably win this and then be one of the top three in the betting for next year's Classic.
Okay, there you go. Simon?
Yeah, Cyberknife for me, unoriginally. So, yeah, that's a... What are you going for, Ross? If you make it 4 out of 4, they always win.
I can't, because it's a dirt race. I've learned my lesson after several years. I can't do it. I can't do it. I'm not doing it. I get it wrong. I get the dirt races wrong every year. I'm still upset about the 5% coming up at Sutherland. I don't think I've got over it, so I can't.
Well, 3 out of 4 ain't bad. That's all I'm saying.
It's 3 out of 3 because I'm abstaining.
Well, That's true.
I'm abstaining. Ian Wick says Laurel River the nap. I think Ian's just contrarian with everything tonight. So, but that's what we need here. You're the Tom Siegel of the piece tonight. Cyberknife for Dante. For that as well. The Breeders' Cup Filly and Mare Turf is up next then. Again, as you would expect, a whole host of European challengers, headed by the Gosden and Doyle combination in the shape of Nashua, who is a 6-4 shot here against old rivals above the curve at 11-2 and Tuesday at 6-1. If you ain't European, you need to be a Chad Brown representative for this race, and he's got quite a few. In Italian is the shortest of those at 7-1. Lugier is also in there for him at 14-1, and Virginia Joy, who's shortened up a little bit at 12s, and it's 14-1 and bigger the rest, including a couple of other European representatives, in particular Toy for the Ballydoyle team as well, who knuckled down nicely on the dropping trip last time and could outrun her odds a little bit. But it's all about Nashua, who... How many times have we seen a Holly Doyle ride come off to perfection and say that was absolutely spot on? But last time out, I still think, I almost think it was one of the rides of the meeting, and Nashua didn't win at Longchamp last time out. Holly Doyle did everything she possibly could to get this horse home, and Plaster Carousel rattled home from God knows where. But she comes up against Above the Curve, she comes up against Tuesday, and she comes up against Chad Brown representatives, which, again... Why does he know how to win this race and nobody else does over in the States?
Because Martin Schwartz and Peter Brandt, his main two owners, buy him French horses and bring them over. I mean, actually, what you want is an ex-Euro who's trained by Chad Brown. Those are what win these races. So it's not just, you know,
very
pure American. It's the ex-French coming over.
Okay. What do you make of the? Is Nashua going to hold off her old rivals?
No.
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 Why not?
John Gosden. I know, everybody is.
Hang on. I think the word is sacrilege. We're looking for that.
Mr. Gosden, 0-6, has only been placed once. Third, the Fugue. I backed her. Disappointing. 11-8 favorite. No, I've learned. No.
Oh, that sounds like just personal pain that you haven't
got
over.
This is a personal opinion.
Fair enough. Yes, it's hard to disagree with that. Nashua 6-4 above the curve, 11-2. I thought Tuesday was a little bit interesting on faster ground over this trip. Rachel's just laughed into her hand.
Do you want to drop the truth bomb, or do you...
Gosden is poor in this 06, go 016 O'Brien.
Right, fair enough.
Joseph, surely Tuesday needs a pit stop, an extra pair of set of Pirelli's putting on, doesn't she? I mean, she's got a flat tyre. I mean...
Well, let's also remember, she's the Oaks winner. I appreciate she was third in the Guineas.
And this is not a mile and a half.
This is a mile 3/16. But didn't nine and win, a half.
Didn't she win the Oaks with a lovely ride that took advantage of that little turn of foot? Is that not?
Yeah, but there's faster horses in here.
Okay, fair enough. Rachel's like, none of this.
I will not have Aidan O'Brien in this race.
Okay,
this will be the year he has only won at the entire Breeders' Cup with one mare.
Yeah. What was her name now?
She took on Boys.
Yes, yeah.
Found was quite good, but that's his only.
The one thing, Ross, about this race, and we've both been eulogising about how good this meeting is. They've got a real problem with the track circumference and layout at Keeneland. This particular race always changes its distance depending on where the turns are. So this really is a difficult fit for a lot of horses because it's a mile and 1.5 furlongs. So it doesn't really have a sit, if you like. Normally, you'd either have horses who want to go longer or they go to the mile and take on the Boys. And therefore, I think this particular race could be rife for a real lights-out boil over.
Okay.
And you're going to ask me which one it is, and I will throw a horse in who I think is chronically overpriced. It wouldn't surprise me. I certainly wouldn't be surprised if Above the Curve goes and beats Nashua. I wouldn't be surprised at all if one of the three Chad Brown horses do it, particularly as they're drawn together. They're going to run as a team. They're coming out at 9, 10, 11. I don't know what price it is. I don't think it's so big. I don't think it makes our board. But this might go the way of Canada, you know. It might go the way of the rank outsider, who I think will outrun its odds.
Not the
one, Lady Spite Spear.
Okay.
Yeah,
Roger Bradfield won this race. His only Breeders' Cup winner was this race in 2011, Perfect Shirl. She is related to Perfect Shirl. She's won her last three starts. She's got progressively better. Yes, she wheeled back to 7 last time out, but that was on the all-weather. Look at the run when she won the Grade 2 Nassau. That was a really decent performance. She's not one-dimensional. She can stalk, she can lead. Louis Sayers gets aboard, which I like. guy who rides Keeneland extremely well. Nothing against Emma Jane Wilson, but they've gone for a Trek specialist rider. I think Lady Spite Spear, simply because she ain't, again, one of the sexy horses. She's chronically overpriced.
Okay, there you go. Big price, 33-1 shot. The inside box for Lady Spite Spear, or Spite Spear, I don't know. Spite Spoo, Spite Clare.
probably Lady Spate Sphere, is it?
Yeah,
Spate Town.
Is this
potato tomato, potato?
Tomato,
not,
yeah, it's an interesting lady. I mean, I must admit, you know, this is a big race for Europe. It's a big race for Holly Doyle. If she can win, I mean, she hasn't put a foot wrong on Nashua, really, on the whole. She rarely puts a wrong foot wrong, full stop. And it doesn't look the strongest filly in mare turf. That said, you're right, Mark. There have been a few big price winners over the years, and that means it could be set up for that if she does get beat. Tuesday's been on the go since March, and I'm a sucker for an eight. Every time you point out these Aidan O'Brien terrible records, I realise I've backed most of those losers, so I'm not backing Tuesday. I'm determined.
We'll have four winners curve this year, won't we?
Yeah. That's right. But I think, you know, Nashua looks very solid. She has, you know, she's very consistent. I say I'd be willing her on and cheering her on. I think of the European, she's the one I want to win most. Great pick out, because it is a race I'm sort of looking at. Is there anything at a bigger price you might throw a few quid at? I'm now drawn in on Lady Spate Spear, thanks to Mark. And in Italian, I just watching that, you know, she's going to go from the front, isn't she? She should be very close to the pace, if not on the pace. And of Chad Brown, she was impressive last time out. I thought, you know, she's the fourth favourite at 7-1. Maybe she's a sort of a solid play, but I'll be cheering on Nashua for sure.
Okay, there you go. I thought you were going to end on in Italian, and I was going to say grazie, Simon, but so I'm going to say it anyway. Breeders' Cup filly and mare turf, Rachel.
I'm going to split my stakes between Above the Curve for Joseph, who has won this race, and Virginia Joy for Chad Brown. This might be too short for her, but she's coming out of the Kia North American Prep in the Flower Bowl at Aqueduct.
Lovely stuff.
Louisville Slugger Time.
Yeah.
Lady Spite Sphere.
There you go.
Out the ballpark each way.
This is absolutely one of those ones that if it wins, you'll never forget it. And if it doesn't, you'll never remember it. you've got, quickly, Simon, price list before we move on.
Price boost was Nashua, so I don't think we've got another price boost unless the producers know more
Holly
than
Doyle,
me.
Holly Doyle, I think. There's a Holly Doyle.
Oh, there's a Holly Doyle to ride a winner at the meeting, isn't there? Which yeah. She is. 6-5? I can't remember.
It's she's on the screen. Six to four.
God, I'm losing the play. She's riding Platinum Queen and Nashua and Floatus, I think, are three rides. And yeah, she's 6-4 from even money to ride at least one winner. And I hope she does. But I'll be tipping in Italian. I'm definitely backing Lady Spate Sphere after Mark's pick out. That's not going unbacked in the Clare household.
Thank you very much. 6-8 at Keeneland then is the Breeders' Cup Sprint. Again, we'll rattle through this one because, we've got homes to go to. plenty of races to come still. Jackie's Warrior, 4-5. Kimari, 9-2. Elite Power, 5s. American Theorem is 9s. 12-1 Aloha West. 28-1 and Bigger the Rest. Scores to be settled for the favourite Jackie's Warrior in this race, who was a borderline certainty last year until she wasn't. Classic mistake of having a woman's name in the name of the horse and me messing it up. Will Jackie's Warrior win this year?
Probably, but not with my support at 4-5. Has been to the Breeders' Cup twice. Went off odds on for the Juvenile in 2020. Finished fourth. That was here over this strip. Went off odds on last year. Finished sixth. Found to have a knee chip operated on. Come back a better horse. This is its last career start, trained specifically for this. If you want to take 4-5, there are better 4-5 shots in the racing world all year. I thought the mare, Kimari, Jose Ortiz for Wesley Ward, was interesting. Maniwar, a huge price horse, but he's a small horse. I don't like his draw. And the old man of the party, CZ Rocket, might run well. He was second here a couple of years ago. I'd find a couple to take on Jackie's Warrior. Not a race I've got a great feeling.
Okay, Rachel, in a sentence, what beats Jackie's Warrior?
Jackie's Warrior.
Yeah, fair enough.
I mean, if he shows up, no one beats him, but I'm in a complete agreement with Mark. I'd probably back CZ Rocket as an each-way play, just as a big price to go in, as this is his third run in the race, and he was second when it was here at Keeneland back in 2020.
There you go. Simon?
Yeah, I'll take on Jackie's Warrior, Kimari. She's run two huge races, 7 from 9 on dirt, so I'm going to back her to beat Jackie's Warrior. But if you fancy Jackie's Warrior to win by over 2 lengths, she's 4-5 to win, but to win by over 2 lengths, she's 3-1 from 5-2. So
you have to say, it is a he. We're all making the same mistake. Oh,
and if you do fancy Jackie's Warrior to overcome the hoodoo of the Breeders' Cup, he will win by distance.
So that's definitely
worth considering. Personally, in fact, that would interest me far more than just a straight win. I would definitely be looking at a big win for Jackie's Warrior if he wins.
At 3-1.
Yeah, definitely.
Because if you lose it 3-1, you're fine. And when you lose it 1-2, you're a little bit...
Fair enough.
We like that one, Simon.
Yep.
There you go.
Good.
Finally, the approval. The approval for a prize boost, Simon. Let's see if we can get any more as we move on.
We're a tough crowd.
To the it's all right. I mean, Simon's price boost always get a tough crowd, to be fair.
Yeah.
It's Breeders' Cup Mile is up next with Modern Games at 2-1 for Charlie Appleby and William Buick. Kinross 100-30, Dreamloper 13-2, Annapolis 8-1, Regal Glory 12s, Malavath 14s, Pogo is Newmarket 16-1, Domestic Spending is 20-1, and it is Bigger the Rest again. Huge European Championship for this race once again. Modern Games coming back for another crack. He's another Appleby Globetrotter who can barely do anything wrong, albeit beaten at Ascot last time out behind the shock winner in the shape of Bayside Boy. But obviously that was a little bit of a strange contest on Champions Day. And he's the 2-1 favourite to go in against Kinross, who's up in trip. Dreamloper, who, if you believe that, that last piece of form definitely has a chance, although do I believe it? That's the question. Malavath, who's got Breeders' Cup form as well. Pogo, who's the pace for the race. And the American Challenge from Annapolis, who's definitely... Take Modern Games, Kinross, and take the European Challenge out, and Annapolis has definitely got the quality to win this contest, Rachel. Modern Games, 2-1. Will you be taking on the Appleby favourite, or is that fair enough?
2-1 is a fantastic price. I genuinely thought he'd be like a Silver Knot 5-6-4 price. I mean, to be honest, I thought he'd be one of the shorter ones. I know this is a tough race. It's the Mall. Anything can happen. But he's drawn in the ideal position in 4. He's got the best form coming into it from a North American perspective, and he's one of the best Brits. And I was a bit worried. I was desperately hoping he wouldn't run in the QE2 because I didn't want Charlie Appleby to leave his race at Ascot.
Yeah.
And I was slightly worried considering the ground and the situation. But since he's landed at Keeneland, been allowed out of the quarantine barn on the track, they literally have to have somebody down on the ground holding him out on track because he is that well within himself. So, you know, to be honest, 2-1, for me, that's like almost a long shot play on what I thought Modern Games would be. But we will at some bigger prices. Yeah, Annapolis is good. Just wealth warning. Todd Pletcher, 0-10. He's got everything going for him. He won the main prep. He beat some of the Euros who came over for it. He's drawn 11, not ideal. Expect him to come running, but I would be a little bit worried with the Todd Pletcher stat. The one I like at a huge price underneath is Ivor. It's his third run in the race. He was third in it last year. He was fourth best of the Americans in 2020. He's an old man, but he always just keeps running. You won't see him at all during the race. You just close your eyes and wait for the results to come up because he's a stone bonking cold closer. But he's a huge price, and he should be thereabouts.
Okay, yeah, he's the. I love horses like him. Mm-hmm. You know exactly what you're going to get, and you back him to do that.
He runs his race. I mean, he's seen the back of Annapolis and Modern Games in his last two starts. He will see the back of them this time, but he's a much bigger price to see the back of them than he has been.
Yeah, and he was placing this at similar odds last year.
Absolutely, so. And if Modern Games hadn't been in the wood by a mile, Ivar would have won that race, and he'd be less than half the price he is now. I agree. I agree with everything Rachel said there. I really like, if you are and a lot of the viewers will know you can watch all the works online. Simon's mentioned it already that you can't really escape the Breeders' Cup in the week running up to it. Yep. If you want to watch horses working, and I watched last night, actually, well, I was commentating at Kempton, but I had a view on what was happening with the works. And I was really pleased how Modern Games came out. I was a little bit worried, like everyone, had he left this big match at Ascot. And when he came out and he led out the entire string of Charlie Appleby's, and if you ever saw a horse who was up for it, he just looked an absolute picture. And that, if you like, has cemented my view that he is still very much the one to beat. And I totally agree. Ivar is just in America, they call him a hard knocker. He just keeps turning up. and you take Modern Games out of it, and he is a huge player.
Okay, Modern Games is a nice price at 2-1, and apparently Ivar has got an engine. big odds. So
I'm not playing the fat controller.
That's absolutely fine.
Well, you say that, Mark.
But over to Thomas the Tank, Simon Clare.
Well, look, we've got to mention. I think Modern Games has the profile, you know, a great profile for this race, and beautifully drawn. He's a really solid play. Kinross, we've got to mention it, obviously coming off in amazing form, you know, 7 furlong, 6 furlong form, stepping up to mile. That draw is ugly, isn't it, in 13, yeah. with horses who are going to go forward inside him. But saying that, I mean, you know, Beyond Brilliant and Smooth Like Straighter, like to go from the front, maybe Pogue on the inside. Yeah. He could get across, couldn't he? I mean, I don't fancy him, but we haven't really mentioned Kinross. Dream Loper, I don't really fancy. Just a couple to chuck in there. I thought Smooth Like Straight, yes. Second in last is Breeders' Cup Mile. Easy to think, well, he keeps getting beat, therefore in a bigger field, more competitive race, why would he be placed? But he could be placed again, couldn't he? He could get into the lead. Obviously, really tough. You can sort of see him being placed again, like that sort of eight Ivar angle. And just one interesting horse, because if anyone's going to produce a horse on seasonal debut to run a big race, it's probably Chad Brown. And it has domestic spending. Got a sneaky each way chance. Does anyone have any belief that he could pop up here?
Yeah, well, he was going to be the antipost favorite for the turf last year before he got scratched because of an injury. He hasn't been seen for 14 months, and Chad Brown says he's just starting to come back to himself now. And to be honest, the turf I think is a weaker race than this is, but he just said he wouldn't be ready for the mile and a half, but he does have form back in the day over 1 mile, and he's been working really well. But from 14, Flavian Pratt, just drop him in, and he'll have the kick at the end. I mean, you wouldn't be shocked if he crossed the finish line in front.
Okay, Breeders' Cup Mile then. Rachel?
Modern Games.
Modern Games it is, Mark.
Modern Games wins, Ivar each way.
Okay, Simon, you selection a quick price boost before we move on?
Yeah, Modern Games to win, and I'm going to go Domestic Spending and Smooth Like Straight each way, because the big price is 20 and 25 to 1. And this is Modern Games in Kinross, both to finish in the top four. 7-4, you get the pair of them in the top four. Obviously, we all seem to think Modern Games will be there. So it's a Tory can get Kinross in the first four as well, get paid out on that. That's 7-4.
Fantastic. We've got three more races to go there. Due to time constraints, we'll rattle through the distaff with Nest at 11-8. Malathart is 3-1. Society 7-1. Clarier 7-1. Search Results 7-1. 20-1 Secret Oath and Blue Stripe and 50-1. Awake at Midnight, which you don't have to be this year. But Nest is the 11-8 favourite for Todd Pletcher, a 3-year-old who, quite frankly, has been putting in some incredible figures on her last few starts. But I've got previous with Malathant. I thought she had a cracking chance in this race last year. It was a bit of a messy renewal, Mark. And I get the feeling you think that she might well upset her shorter price stablemate.
I thought she might win last year, and she didn't. There are two things that are different this year. Number one, she's got blinkers. She's been a totally different mare since she got blinkers applied. Number two, last year was at Del Mar. She don't like the sun.
Yeah.
Now it's in Kentucky. She likes Kentucky. She's 3-3 at the track. These two horses, Nest and Malathart, both trained by Todd Pletcher. They both work together. Mm. If you back them off looking them working, the figures say Nest's the better horse. The work suggests Malathart, if she's not as good or better, she's damn close to it.
Okay, again, so I'm sensing a Forte Malathart absolute thiever each way double coming on, potentially. come on, I like that. Yeah, there we go. I'm going to get involved in that. Rachel, what do you think?
Yeah, what he said.
Okay, there you go. All this stuff. Simon, are you...
Definitely, I'm with that Malathart. Watched last year's distaff. It was a crazy race. The speed they went up front, it fell apart, and you know, it almost ruined the race, and she still ran really well behind the Japanese winner, Marshall Rain. She's just tough. It always turns up. I think she's a solid bet at 3-1.
Okay, Ness is 11-8, and Malathart is a 3-1 shot in the distaff. Last couple of the races are for the Breeders' Cup 2022. We've got the Classic to close us out, of course, but the Breeders' Cup Turf, we will have a look at first. And, well, what do you know if it isn't a Charlie Appleby favourite? And now joint second favourite with Nation's Pride and Rebel's Romance. 9-4 Nation's Pride, Rebel's Romance is 4-1. Splitting them is Warlike Goddess in at 4-1 for Bill Mott. And then 11-2 Mischief trying to sort of, I guess, salvage his reputation. Might be a bit harsh, but it's been a frustrating year for him. Stone Age is 9-1 with Broom at 14-1. Say what you like about him, but he ran a cracker in this last year. Highland Chief, which you'll remember from a couple of years ago for Paul and Oliver Cole. It's 20-1. It's 25-1. Bar those, given that your beer beat Broome in this race last year, quite frankly, anything can happen. But Nation's Pride and Rebel's Romance have been in cracking nick for Charlie Appleby. Nation's Pride again, another Globetrotter. And Rebel's Romance, again, an aborted experiment on the dirt. Rebel's Romance said, thanks, I was hating every second of that. This is what I want, and to thank you for not running me in the dirt at Maidan, I'm going to win every race you throw me into. So, cracking lineup for the Breeders' Cup Turf. Are we going to... I mean, like I said, if your beer can win, Rachel, then, quite frankly, well, all bets are off or on. What do you think?
I agree. Last year was just, we'll just put a line through last year. But but Nation's Pride is a very similar horse to your beer, mm-hmm. but he's actually gone more heavily American. He actually was stabled up at Saratoga during the summer, so Charlie Appleby didn't see a lot of him. And if it wasn't for a less tactically astute ride by a certain El Dottore, he would be 3-3 in New York. Mm-hmm. But his win last time in the Jockey Club Derby Invitational, I mean, that's the same race that your beer won. He won it by 6.25 lengths, and he did it really well. Frankie gave him a belter of a ride that day, slingshot off the turn, and he has the American turf turning sort of kick that you want to win this race. So for me, of the two pair, Charlie Appleby is Nation's Pride, but my heart is with Warlike Goddess. She is the best turf horse in America. She's a she. Americans don't run girls against the boys in most races. In fact, while 5 filly and mares have actually won the turf, only 11 North American trained fillies have even contested it. And it's been a long time since there's been one. So Bill Mott just said the mile and 3:16, too short for Warlike Goddess. She's 5-5 over a mile and a half. She ran against the boys. She won against the boys in the chief US prep last time out. She might be a little bit too slow if we're going to go head toe-to-toe in a final sprint to the line with Nation's Pride, but... while the head says Nation's Pride, the price and the heart say Warlike Goddess.
Okay, Warlike Goddess is a 4-1 shot. Nation's Pride 9-4. Interesting that that poorly judged Dottore ride was. It was in the height of the summer where, as Mr. Gosden will tell you, he was a menace. Didn't have his eye on the ball.
Well, that's when they were having a break.
They were,
for like 3.5 minutes.
And that's when he got the... Charlie gave him 2 rides over in New York, so he went to the Big Apple for 2 rides.
Yeah. But his eye was very much on the ball last time out.
It was.
He's not aboard, of course. William Buick is on. He gets the job of trying to guide Mishriff in first time blinkers from box 11.
He does.
Good luck.
He is trying to recover a career. Recover a stallion career.
Well, yes. Perhaps. Yeah, fair, yeah.
If you'd asked me 3 months ago, maybe, or 2 months ago, which race would Mishriff be running in, I'd say, yeah, be running on Breeders' Cup Saturday. Mm-hmm. Be running 45 minutes later.
Yeah.
Be running in the Classic.
Yeah.
He isn't. He won't win this. Nation's Pride against the 3-year-olds in America discussed. 3-year-old middle-distance turf horses.
What 3-year-old middle-distance turf horses?
He's 2 out of 3 in a very bad division.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he did, well, I guess you could say
he did. Beaten by daylight, but...
Well, he beat Annapolis 2 starts ago.
Yes.
Over a trip way too far.
Who's not turned up here.
Couldn't you say the same thing about your beer last year as well, though?
Well, he could have, yeah. Yeah, absolutely, but...
Okay, but he was 8-9-1 rather than 9-4, I guess.
Match bet of 2 Appleby horses. Yeah. I'm not convinced Nation's Pride is the one I'd want to be on. In fact... I'll cut the chase. If I were playing this at the prices we've got, I'd actually split my stakes and I'd try to get myself a 3-1 winner with those prices. I'd take Warlike Goddess, I'd take Rebel's Romance, and I'd back them by splitting my stakes.
Well, let's have a fun little story, shall we? So a couple of years ago, Old Persian went and ran in the Grosse Prize von Berlin. I mean, albeit finished behind.
You could say Baden-Baden, then, weren't you?
No. And Walton Street did the same thing, and he won. And then they both went to Canada, so a little bit of a distance. And then they... started in the Breeders' Cup Turf. And they're both actually still somewhere on those various tracks in the races. So this is the way that Charlie Appleby doesn't win the turf. Charlie's also on record as saying that Rebel's Romance, and you can see it in the works, is a huge, top-heavy horse, probably German turf suited during the summer. Mm. He's actually a bit afraid of him being a little bit slow around the turns, that once he gets back on his right lead and starts to kick... the race has already developed well in front of him. I wouldn't be surprised to see him charging late, but even Appleby's thinking he's not the right type of horse physically to be getting around the turns.
Yes, but let's bring global warming into this argument. You see...
Well, I mean, let's keep it to the races.
Is it like
Mark,
the cops?
German turf of 2022 isn't the German turf of 2018 or 19.
Yeah, but it ain't Kentucky turf.
It's but it's loose. And it's loose at Keeneland, but he was not winning on bottomless German turf that you would normally expect to see.
Okay.
He comes with a different German profile than a lot of the others that have been described.
Very well. I'm going to have to ring a bell here.
we're going to fight. You carry on.
You can't go. Simon, please, we need a towel in here.
It's a fascinating debate, even just to try and work out the two athlete horses. I mean, Nation's Pride has been the better back for the last couple of days, 9-4. The In the Nose special is actually a Charlie Appleby special. Both Nation's Pride and Rebel Romance to be in the top four, to finish in the top four. That's 2-1 from 6-4. I'm just going to throw one in here, which I know they'll have to check ahead. Mishriff, second in the Jump Monty, second in the Coral Eclipse, fourth in the Irish Champion Close Up. Verdaney was third, second in the Arc. I mean, he still is. He's probably still the best horse in the race on ratings, isn't he?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, if Yabir can do it, then Mishriff can do it, can't it?
Well, so Dangerous Midge, Red Rocks. I wouldn't get too hung up on the sort of horses who can win a Breeders' Cup Turf. It's more who's the right horse. Well, to be fair, what it says is actually you shouldn't necessarily go for the highest rated horse because that doesn't necessarily win the Breeders' Cup Turf. But I wondered about Mishriff. I half wondered about Stone Age. Close, you know, wasn't beaten far in the Irish Champion. Look, I find it really tricky race. Nation's Pride looks almost too obvious, and if you don't back him, Broome was second last year, like you said. So it's one of those funny races. This one, I haven't got a strong opinion.
Okay, there we go. Let's get an opinion before we move on to the classic. Rachel,
Warlike Goddess.
Warlike Goddess. Mark,
Warlike Goddess and Rebel's Romance. At those odds, split stakes.
Okay, Simon.
Because I let my heart rule my head, I'm going to back Mishriff to end his career on a high.
Okay, here you go.
John Gosden has done very similar things in the past. Just rock up, horse, Frankie Dettori, first time headgear, blitzes from the front or whatever, and we all just sit back going, Maestro's done
exactly.
It again.
Maybe he doesn't know what he's doing. Last race of the weekend then will be the Breeders' Cup Classic, of course. Again, we're at a very respectable time at 9:40. The headline act, Flightline, 2-5 for the closing race on the card. And I mean, if that race last time out is anything to go by, then, well, he wins this by half the track. But it's not necessarily going to happen. And Epicenter is a very good horse in its own right, as his life is good. Again, take the flight line out. And those two have put in some really good numbers to get involved in this. Taiba is 12-1 as well. Hot Rod Charlie, 33s, and Olympiad as well. 40-1 and bigger the rest. Again, I knew this would happen. Breeders' Cup Classic, we get to the end and we're tight for time. It always happens with meetings like this. But flight line was incredible last time out. I guess the question is just, what did he beat, and can he do it again against an improving three-year-old?
He beat Trees, and probably, but I'm not taking that price to pay for it. There's only one play in this race, personally, and that's backing Life is Good, which is insulting at 15-2 or thereabouts. That's a proper each-way play for me, or if you want to split your stake, have a little bit to win and a lot to place on him, because I really can't see him not being in the top three. He's the best of the sort of the unexposed horses. He won the Dirt Mile last year. The Dirt Mile is a three-year-old. The Breeders' Cup Classic is a four-year-old. The likes of Gunrunner and Nick's Go in the last couple of years has become the sexy race. Todd Pletcher's won this before. He's got a bit of speed. He's drawn to the inside of Flightline. Todd Pletcher said they're not changing run style, so he's going to go. He's going to lay it up to Flightline. That's where my money would be in this race. And if Flightline is just that good, I will sit back, lose my money, and clap him home just to see a phenomenal horse.
There you go. Life is Good as a 15-2 then. Each way angle against Flightline, Mark.
Well, if anybody out there has been living on Clanger Planet for the last month and a half, they don't know who Flightline is. He's raced five times. He's won five times. Winning distance total 62¾ lengths. It equates to 12½ lengths for each of his victories. And he's been, well, they've never laid a glove on him. And he's even blown the start twice, and that hasn't mattered. John Saddler, the trainer, has won this race once in 2018 with Accelerate. That's his only winner in 54 winners at the Breeders' Cup. He's got a couple more horses running before this. And probably more significantly, Flightline has travelled out of Southern California. He did it once and he won at Belmont, although that was his least impressive victory when he won the Met Mile. he'll probably win. I will do the same as Rachel. I wouldn't advise anybody to back him if you just applaud a superstar. I thought Epicenter was worth definitely taking a play on. It's his first run against Elders. Steve Asmussen's got a great record in this race. He's won it with Gunrunner and with Curling. Emphatic winner of the Travers last time out. And if you see that price at the moment at 11-2 and you want to get yourself a little bit of an each-way bet with just a smidgen of icing profit on top, back Epicenter now, because last time out he beat Cyberknife and absolutely tonked Cyberknife. And as many of us believe, Cyberknife will win the big-ass fans' dirt mile on Friday, that price may well collapse.
Yeah.
So he's definitely a play now.
I mean, if it wasn't for Flightline, if you had a three-year-old who came into this with the numbers that he had last time out, he you know, we'd be looking at a sort of 6-4 favourite.
We would, so. Yeah. We would, if not even a smidge shorter, yeah.
I mean, the one thing that we do just have to say, if you do want to try and get a price, is yesterday, Happy Saver, basically the horse that's filling this out, so there's 8 runners, didn't work, didn't train, because he had a quarter crack, it's been patched, Todd Pletcher is hopeful he'll get to the race. So this might be one. Maybe monitor various news channels for the next 24 hours because you certainly don't want to be having a bet currently if all of a sudden you're only going to get it 7 places. I mean, unless you're going to back Flightline, in which do it now because it'll probably shorten if one horse comes out of the race.
Okay. Unless, of course, he does a blame, which I shouldn't have mentioned because I know Mark could do a whole show on blame, I think, beating Zenyatta. But Flightline 2-5, Epicenter 11-2. Simon, wrap us up with the classic, please.
Yeah, look, I mean, you mentioned Blame and Zenyatta, I know we always end up focusing a lot on the turf races at the Breeders' Cup because of the European interest, but the classic is the race. Anyone who goes to the Breeders' Cup knows that the atmosphere just changes. The moment the turf's over and that 20 minutes, half an hour build up to the classic, it's amazing. And the roar when they come out of the traps, come out of the boxes. And, you know, this is another one of those races. The Kentucky Derby winner's in there. I know he's a big price winner, Rich Strike. You've got the top class horse like Life is Good running against Flightline. But he is the star of the show, isn't he? And the In the Know special, given Mark kindly set up that his least impressive winning distance was 6 lengths, you can back him at 2-1 to win by over 5 lengths. So he's 2-5 to win the race. But if you believe Flightline is going to win and win by over 5, you can back him at 2-1, which, given his record to date, sounds entirely feasible. So I'd suggest maybe that's a fun one to have a play at. But aside from that, I think he'll probably win, won't he? And it's just one to sit back and enjoy and really soak up the atmosphere.
Okay, Breeders' Cup Classic. Then, Rachel?
Small win, big place on Life is Good.
There we go. Mark?
Epicenter, each way and place.
There we go. Simon?
The In the Know special, if I could take it at 2-1 to win by over 5 lengths. But I'd probably, if there's 3 places, a good point by Rachel. Wait to see if there are 8 runners come race time tomorrow because the Happy Savers, it's such minor issue. I'd try and find something. Maybe Hot Rod Charlie always runs his race. He's a tough campaigner. 33-1 to run into a place off the pace.
Yeah, if there's 8 places, Malathart, Forte, Epicenter, each way doubles and trebles. Now we're getting each way thievery. I have to go in with a false moustache to get that better on, I think. But let's wrap up the Breeders' Cup preview there, 2022, with the best bets from the panel. Plenty of races to choose from. Rachel, nap of the meeting, please.
It's in the mile. It is Modern Games.
Modern Games it is for the Appleby team.
In the distaff for me, it's going to be Malathart.
Okay, lovely. And Mr. Clare?
And Nashua will win the Filly Meta.
Okay, and it's just been such a good year following Carl Burke's Juveniles. I'm hoping that Dramatize gets that lovely toe in the Juvenile Turf Sprint. And if it doesn't, then at least it'll be over very soon indeed. Thoroughly enjoyed that. I was absolutely rattled by you.
Yes,
absolutely rattled by it. Rachel, Mark, absolute pleasure.
Thank you. No problem. Enjoyed it. Thank you.
I hope the meeting's as good as I feel it's going to be, given the preview. Simon, thank you ever so much once again.
Thank you.
Very different fair next week, I think, Simon. Jumpers just going to be very different. Very different indeed. And thank you to everyone for watching at home as well. If you haven't already, like the stream, get involved in next week's show. We're going to be back most Fridays on the run up to the end of the year. And enjoy 2 days at Keeneland. Good night.